testing on?
Yeah.
All right, thanks, and super excited to see so many people here. It's my second time in Dublin, after many more to come, I'm sure. Very excited to be here. Great weather. I am, as I said, Morten, one of the founders and CTO of Zendesk, and I'm here to tell you sort of the story behind Zendesk and what we've done through the years. I'm not going to get into such deep level of technology, but I'm happy to talk about anything, any part of the stack, whenever. But I want to rather tell the story of sort of how things came together for us and what our journey looked like, and some of the challenges we ran into, technical scaling, why we have the organization we do today, organizational scaling, and at least what we're up to. So first a little background on current state of affairs. We just celebrated 1,000 employees, which is huge. It's just a lot of people, and it's a very different company when it's just the three of us in a little loft somewhere in Copenhagen. Bunch of customers. We went public last year, as you might know. We have official offices in 11 different locations, and so one thing is like, what do we do to keep all these people busy? I'll get into that, some of the product stories. So the story actually starts 10 years ago in Copenhagen, where Mikkel, Alexander and I had independent careers as independent consultants, and Alex was doing like web development and product management consulting. I was doing security work for banks mostly, lots of Java, lots of applets and that kind of stuff. And I was in very early Apple OSX adopter, and I was dead set on making those apps work before signing in. Turns out there's a real reason they couldn't be fixed ever, but that's a different story. But generally back then we were all like in these comfortable jobs, making good money and good pay, and there was something missing, or something was just wrong for us. This is like 2006. 9 years ago, we were in the scaffolding outside Mikkel's apartment having wine and cigarettes, and as you can tell, we were visibly upset about the state of customer service somewhere. since the dot-com bust, where I worked with Mikkel and his former company, we had reunited another company in between Zendesk and back then, where we sold these enterprise health systems. And we weren't really happy with how that worked. We weren't really happy how they looked. We weren't happy about the sales model, where it was, you know, we would go out and pitch this million-dollar product to some CIO somewhere, which is, yeah, buy it, it's Remedy, it's awesome, it's configurable. And then pay us another $1 million to customize it, and then they shove it down the throats of the poor customer service advocates, and we just have to sit with these terrible systems. And then a year later, when they needed an upgrade, we would come out and make even more money because they broke the upgrade path as part of the customization. So it's a pretty terrible way to sell new software. We didn't really like that. And we knew Alexander way back from the dot-com days where we had been building software. We were an application service provider back then, which is what we call SaaS today. So we had some good experience with that, and we'd been really bitten by the product bug back then, and we wanted to get back into that and build products. So we had this broken thing on the other hand, and then ambition to build product on the other hand, and we just needed a third guy to come in there and sort of tear us apart and get into fights, and then got Alex to take that role. Alright, so that's sort of how we started to get on track with this, and then we set out my first email ever from Alexander, it was in 2005, where he emailed me, hey, could I download that Ruby on Rails book from somewhere? And I responded with this URL to my university account, where this PDF file was DHH's first book, I don't know what it's called, just Ruby on Rails or something, the pragmatic programming book, the first one, and the links that works. And so that's how we got together early on. That's like 10 years ago now, so it takes a while. All right, I often get asked, you know, what would you do differently if you were to start today? And sometimes I talk about how I would have wished I was better at seeing perspective sometimes when you're really entrenched and under attack by the internet. But I think it's also helpful to think about how were the times when we started this company. And not only has Zendesk grown into this great company, bunch of people, we've also gone through a journey like as humankind as a whole. Like 2006, this was like the smartphone story, right? And I don't know how many of you had one of these, but those who did, if you remember, when you pushed the button that said internet, absolutely nothing happened. Right? it was just a different time, right? The iPhone was 7, 8 years old now, and that didn't exist back then. So the mobile stores is so very different. Back then, you know, when we started building stuff, we started with a server in a cluster. Literally, I had a one-unit machine, like, huffing and puffing in my cluster, and that's where we deployed the many first versions of Zendesk. That's where we ran some version. And that was sort of it for us. Today, our IT department has more hardware than we used to host the first 10, 20,000 customers. And we were running, you know, Rails 1.16. It was a very young framework. None of the security features that we've been struggling with ever since were there. Today, of course, different story. AWS, all the power you want, your fingertips, amazing. This was actually Remedy, not necessarily in that hardware, but you know, this was what grew up against on the product side. That was software for you. That was technology, right? 2006. It seems long ago, but it's just 9 years, right? So these were all sort of our motivations, and these were the places we started. This is Denmark, 2006. This is the startup community, the investment climate. It was terrible. There's nothing like this here, you know, nothing. And there were no people there who sort of wanted to bet money on three guys trying to build a company. You know? It did not work. So I don't know how many of you read Nicole's book, but we managed to make things make ends meet, and we had no salaries, we had no money, we had no investors, so we asked friends and family to pitch in and help us along with it, and thankfully that worked out, and we'll get back to that. Anyway, so we got together despite all of these things, and we just had this passion to build a good product. I always liked customer service, because you know I'm an engineer, I like to build stuff for people, and it just resonates with me. So it was just a good thing for us, and we saw the business opportunity as well, and it was just a good project to get going with it. So the journey starts once we start to build something. You know, we start out in our spare times, as one does, maintain some consultancy gigs on the side, and it starts really easily, really small, you know, and it's primitive, right? We had a tag cloud because those were hot, but this is like how we did, you know. Like anyone would do today, take a piece of paper and start sort of marking up the user interfaces, and then you figure out, okay, how are we going to make this real, and you start implementing. And how do you do engineering? Well, this was me and Alexander, engineering, right? I'd worked with David Heinemann Hansen at Nicole's earlier startup, where he was this super opinionated guy, well known and loved. And when I got together with Alex, he came out of the .NET world, and I came out of this Unix Java world. I was like, yeah, there's no way we're going to do the .NET stuff. And I understand if you're not really a fan of Java, but I knew David was up to this Ruby on Rails thing, and you know, he's a good salesman. Yeah, just use a gem, just use a plugin, it's going to be fine. All right. You know. So we started building that, and that was like in our spare time throughout 2006, so evenings, weekends, whatever. Sometimes in between consultancy gigs, we'd squeeze in a few weeks or months, and eventually sort of we had a product we'd go live with. And we did that in October 2007. At one point in time, we also went full time. So this was our office back then, up here, on the top floor under the ceiling, Alexander's downtown apartment in Copenhagen. And very, very cool bachelor pad he had back then. And we'd walk up these windy stairs, wooden stairs. This building's like hundreds of years old. And you know, knock on the door in the morning, and he'd come out with his bathrobe and get us in, and we just didn't work. Sometimes, some days, not even talking, just sitting there. You know. Anyway, we went live in 2007. We had a little pocket change from friends and family that keeps us alive for, you know, 6 months, perhaps. And the moment we went live, it was like, you know, I opened up the firewall, you know, Mikkel and Alex, all right, we're live. And Mikkel immediately pushes, like, publish on this newsletter. He sends out emails to, like, these hundreds of people who signed up because they're interested in what we're doing. And Alex was a little taken aback with that. He's like, hey, you know, we should have tested around, we should have poked around the first method unit test. You know? We should have poked this around to see if things work. This was way too quick. And Mikkel's like, well, welcome to the next 3 months of your life. Because despite having spent a year and a half building this in our spare time, you know, blood and sweat and all, that was sort of the road we had ahead of us. You know, that's how much runway we had to sort of keep going at this. And we needed to see something committed, went full time, and tried to make things happen from there. We were live at Engine Yard. Back then, Engine Yard was a different kind of company. I don't know how many know them today, but they're sort of like a EC2 glorified services on top of that. Back then, they had their own hardware. They built out their own cages. It was the closest we could get to a cloud. EC2 was barely happening. S3 was there, but it was still barely happening, and you didn't really know if you could bet on it or not. One of the founders of Engine Yard, the late, sadly, Ezra, was a fantastic engineer, infrastructure guy, who had built out good deployment setups, and who had built out a good set of services to host Rails applications. So that means, you know, I wanted to deploy somewhere where if something went wrong, there'd be qualified people who could do something in case I was unreachable. We didn't have like 24/7 coverage in a small startup. So we went with them on their dedicated hardware. Eventually our ways parted, but we'll get to that later. All right, so fast forward a little. This is I don't know how many use New Relic, but this is from our Engine Yard 01S00116 slice. Virtual machine with 640 megabytes of memory. And our master node here, three modules initially. And it was very, very intense. But this is here, like, what, that was me 8 months in, and we have a throughput of 20 requests per minute. That was pretty easy. So it was very uneventful in the first many years, which is sort of what happens for SaaS businesses, or especially businesses where the idea is to get volume and then make money, and then the volume gives you robustness. The first many customers will pay you, what, 10 bucks a month? It's nothing. It takes a long time to build up something from that. And that was back then, right? Today it's different. You can just go out there and you build some impressive systems and take on lots of traffic right away and scale it in a very different way. Anyway, we were sitting in an excellent science apartment, and then one day we managed to get Twitter as a customer, which was a big deal. That was early 2009. So Twitter, some companies started to pick up on us in San Francisco because some first movers used us, and then they talked to their board about that, and then they started using us. So we got some really great companies picking us up very early on, and Twitter was one of those companies. The reason Twitter went with us was that their head of support at the time, Crystal, she really liked our colors. And that's how you can get lucky, you know, once in a while. And Twitter just grew so much more fast than we did. And that's reflected directly on us. You know, they had a team and funding, we were just like sitting in the kitchen. And so we started dealing with lots of platform scaling issues already back then. One day, Oprah mentions Twitter. And we were sitting in the kitchen, and all of a sudden we just got flooded with tickets for the Twitter account. What just happened? And they're getting 10,000 tickets, you know, which today is like nothing for us, right? But that just took our database up entirely. You know? So it's just keeping up with all that mess. We spent a fair amount of time on that for a long, long time. But that was our first sort of introduction to, okay, what's it mean to scale something on a technical level? A good thing with Twitter, with getting them as a customer early on, was also that a good bad thing was that they would use twitter.zendesk.com as their support address. So, you know, we got a lot of publicity there. And back then there was this website called compete.com. It sort of gauges how much traction your website's getting. And Zendesk just exploded, Zendesk.com, because of the twitter.zendesk.com. And I think that sort of got some interest from different VCs. Some people who didn't believe in us was the original TechCrunch 40 back at the time. He says TechCrunch 50 here, but there's only 40 when we applied. One late night, we called the US, and we spoke to Mike Arrington and Jason Calcanis, and we all of us wanted to call, very confusing. And I remember Calcanis saying, so this is what? This like a help desk with an RSS feed? You know, and that's sort of how he saw us. And that's probably true, it was. But it was also a radical simplification of what existed. It was a big change. Maybe you've heard the concept of 10xing something. It was a big change where we made a 10x improvement in how things were delivered, how they were accessible, and they thought that was too simple, even for the time. Right? Simple works, you know. You don't need any so we kept grinding, slightly disillusioned, but the war sparked part over because someone else got a good look at us. And this was a guy, his name is Devdutt Yellowcar. He's a venture capitalist from Charles River Ventures out of Boston. And he was doing some due diligence on one of his existing investments who were in the customer service sector. And he's like, should I invest more in these guys? Let me see what else is out there. And then he found us. And he liked the design, he liked our approach. So he flew in from Boston and was interested in giving us our first investment. So this was like early summer 2009. So we took our Series A in hand and moved to Boston, the Leopard District, rented a regular apartment, got some IKEA furniture, moved in. that was our new loft, and we sat there instead. But this is also where I started sending the first real engineering team. So far, we've only had a couple of guys freelance out of Argentina and a single freelance in Copenhagen to help us out with engineering. And now it's time, let's build a real team. So I hired five guys, good guys, and then you start realizing that this product you've been building for 3 years without really testing or documenting, it's really hard for someone else to pick up. People don't move with confidence. So one of my realizations was reflected by this guy a few years ago, which I think is just a fantastic way of looking at it. We came out of this just a couple of guys giving all we had, not really thinking about long time longevity of the software we're writing, and what it means for other people to be able to succeed on the software you're writing. So that's something we really adopted there in 2009, and somehow it was other people to contribute to our stuff, and we still need to deploy all the time. Even back then, we deployed a lot and make sure that our software was out for all the customers. Here's a graph that shows what we call classic today. It's like the old original code base. It's still it's our API backend today. This is the blue line is the lines of code in classic, and red line is lines of test code for classic, right? So it's, and that changed right around here, late October 2009, where we're like, okay, we gotta set this up. We gotta deploy with confidence, because otherwise, long term, it's gonna be a really, really stressful job to be an engineer. So we settled into Boston. The moment we set foot pretty much in the US, transferred our intellectual property to the US, and committed ourselves to be in the US, we got four Series B offers. So all of a sudden, we're out of this thing being stuck in Denmark, and all of a sudden, the US VCs had such an easier time to invest in us because we were there. And we ended up taking that Series B offer before we needed it, and got some good terms on that. And we also got the offer to move to San Francisco. So we moved engineering to San Francisco. That was not fun because we just hired these guys 2 months prior. Fine, we're gonna move to San Francisco. You wanna come? People's lives were there, We gave them good options to join us, but of course you don't just do that after 2 months with the company. And we've gotten good traction throughout 2009, and now we have to start all over with engineering again in San Francisco, which is an entirely different animal when it comes to recruiting and to finding people. This was still sort of subprime crisis time, so the bubble was not near anywhere where it is today. It was a different kind of environment. But it still takes a while to onboard new people, and it takes a while to find people who can take responsibility of different parts of the engineering organization. So my life for the next year and a half was pretty hard. Hiring is just terribly hard. You're competing with Twitter, Facebook, Google, all these guys, right? I'm from Denmark, where people apply for a job. In San Francisco, you chase people down the street and convince them to work. It's just very different. Scaling is hard. I was the guy who knew most about infrastructure, so it was on me to figure that out. I'd leave work late and say, wake up in the morning, take my work, fix some stuff, wake up in the morning, see 200 emails, and fix some stuff. And definitely not recommendable, but that was sort of the cost of moving fast, right? And that's something we felt we had to do, and I wouldn't do it over. I would probably do it differently, but I wouldn't do it over. The things you realize here is sort of when the problem you're working on fits into database memory, you're good. Outside that, really bad spot to be in. So that's the stuff you come against for a long, long time when you scale out your platform, especially pre-AWS, and especially back when you have to write your own sharding code with MySQL. Getting to that. Eventually, we managed to hire some good people. This is Zendesk Engineering around 2010. And we had again like a basic product management organization in place. We get some directors and VPs in to sort of build out the organization, turn on recruiting, finding good people, owning infrastructure, owning operations. So basically just building a real proper organization. And that's sort of the trajectory we've been on ever since, getting the good stable organization in place. All right, so those were the first years moving to the US. I'm gonna talk a bit about technology. We were just a simple Rails app on MySQL, some Memcache, that's sort of it. And we had lived in this environment where we had a shared database initially, then we got our own database, 4 gigabytes of memory, and then we kept cranking the memory up, 8, 16, 32, 64, and we had 128 total. And we just see, all right, we're gonna run out of capacity pretty soon. So what do we do? At this time, we parted ways from Engineers. They couldn't provide hardware for us fast enough, and they were also looking to say that this time EC2 was more apparent, so that they were looking to move their business onto EC2 and compete with Heroku, who were doing really great. So they offered us this deal and some hardware and crazy expensive data centers, no thanks, and we moved off to Rackspace. But we could finally start to deal with this burning house that we were living in terms of infrastructure and do something right and invest in that. So moving to Rackspace, we could get a lot more hardware. And one of the things we did was get some of these guys. I don't know if you know what this is. Yeah, it's a Fusion IO, right? So it's basically a flash hard drive. Not many people did that in 2010. And there are still all these rumors that, it's gonna run out of space and you can't reclaim it. And all these sort of fear and certainty doubts, elements of it. But the throughput we got from these guys was just freaking amazing, you know? I don't know if you do like loaded database stuff, but we went from having an IO subsystem that was just pegged all the time, like when you did an ALTO statement, you just pegged the entire IO subsystem. But on these guys, they're just idling, and you had a CPU that's maxed out instead. This is truly amazing technology, especially for the time. So it sounds like a dream, right? And it sort of was, except, what happens when you get early new technology, you're going to run into some things. You're going to run into some things that people didn't see before. One of these was that MySQL locking did not really anticipate the kind of throughput this hardware could give. So the contention became something different than we used on spindles. And in there, somewhere as an edge case, we managed to trigger, which caused a database to crash and not come back up. So like all everything's NODB here, and it would crash and would not come back up. And what do you do? We had two slaves because we needed one slave for backups, the other slave just for master slave replication. So we failed over. All right, so we could fail over and then have it again. All right, that wasn't fun. So we managed to unwitch a server. So all right, so we had two slaves or two databases, and we set up the third one was down. And we were tired. We've been doing this 24/7 for a couple of days, and then went home, got some sleep. Called the middle of the night, we crashed again. All right, screw it. So we got up in the middle of the night, and we had understood enough that this happened in the same kind of area of the database all the time. So it was a race condition on drop fields. So I called two of our more senior engineers. They're still with us today, thankfully, not because of this. Mick and Ben said, all right, guys, we've got to figure this out. We've got to work around this. And in the middle of the night, you do that. And you're on the last database. If this crashes, you don't know how much time you have. It's a pretty terrible situation to be in. But we managed to say, okay, we're going to change the data type of this field now. We're going to say we won't accept blobs anymore. We're going to fix it this way. And we managed to sort of go through the night and things worked out for us. What was interesting from that is, so our COO at the time, he was ex-MySQL. So he knew a bunch of people there and could give us sort of a outline to some really smart guys there. And we sent them we managed to reproduce this. We sent them this test case and they fixed it and we got a patch really fast. And that was super nice. And that's a good story because it talks a little to how Silicon Valley operates. The networks there are very small and there's access to a lot of really bright and connected people. really appreciate the most about us being there at the time. Anyway, after this, we started running with three slaves for like 3 years, just out of paranoia. So we got on to using better hardware for the databases. Eventually, you're going to think about those disks are going to run full as well. The memory you're going to run out of that as well. And so we start doing sharding. So we've written our own sharding libraries to split up load between different database clusters. So one of our accounts lives on a given shard that belongs in a given hardware cluster, an actual database in a given hardware cluster. So when you go to like some subdomain.zendesk.com, the DNS routes you to the right data center, and in there you end up the right shard. Sharding conceptually is pretty simple, but operationally and technically kind of annoying to deal with. Engineers need to know about it, it gets in the way. Operations need to know about how do we load balance across these shards. What does that look like? What if one shard runs out of disk space? And by load balancing, we're going to come from here to here. What about IDs? Can they collide? Are they allowed to? So do we have like global unique IDs and how do we implement that? It's a mess to deal with, and I think you know things like AWS Aurora looks a lot more like the future than you sharding yourself. But you know that's just 5 years ago, right? Different times. When you build something as complicated as Zendesk, you know, a huge distributed system, downtime will happen. We have someone updated me today. We have 2,500 hosts in production. Stuff will fail every day, and you have to build in resiliency and you have to deal with that. So you know we always try to be transparent and post-mortems about what's going wrong and own our failures when they happen. And we are very focused on getting better at building for you know operational scale and resiliency these days. It's just because that's just the nature of the game. You can't just stop as a SaaS software provider. You can't you crash in on the arrival. I was maybe obvious that day. Alright, just an anecdote on Ruby and Ruby on Rails. It's many years ago, I don't know, many years ago, 193 was hot, but just to show, the technology we relied on were apparently pretty immature when we picked them, they've done better, and I'm sure that 223 down here is much better yet, but just to say, you know, Ruby and Ruby on Rails have seen many shifts as well since then. I would say Rails pulled things in the opposite direction than this, but that's a different story. We had a hard time getting on 3.2, and I'm slightly sad to hear that 4.2 is another 20% hit, because from 2.3 to 3.2 was like a 3x performance hit for us, and we had to figure that out, find that time somewhere else. All right, last part of this, scaling teams. So how's our team grown? Hiring in San Francisco was super hard. We came from Copenhagen, moved to Boston, and then San Francisco. And hiring was just so hard there, and we're like, okay, what can we do? What's the shortcut we can take? Well, we knew Copenhagen pretty well. We had a network there, we had a brand there, we knew a bunch of engineers. So in 2011, Mikkel sent an email to the local Copenhagen Ruby Brigade. He said, hey guys, we're in this situation. Setting up an office in Copenhagen, would you be interested? I think we got like 10 positives back. Yeah, that'd be interesting. So that summer I flew over and interviewed a bunch of people and we hired 5, who then became the core of our Copenhagen engineering outfit. And we learned a lot from that, but mostly that it could be done. And this was something we probably do elsewhere as well. We opened Melbourne and Dublin in 2012. And later, Singapore, we acquired a company there in 2014. And that most recent Madison, and Madison and Manila as well, actually. So how do we make this work? How do we even figure out how to communicate and build the same product and not step on each other's toes? I think that's a huge challenge. It still is today, but I like to believe we are getting better at doing it right in a way that doesn't get in the way of our engineers. A big part of the response is, I think, having good engineering culture. I mean, there's always something we can do better, want to do better. I think that's just a fact of life. We always have stuff we want to fix. If we're an engineer, we fix it. And so we think a lot about our engineering culture. What does a good culture look like? You know? I have some ideas. The teams have some ideas. You know, and we talk about this and figure out what works for us going forward. What's the best best rational decision we can make now that doesn't go in and inhibit you in your work and doesn't cause problems, but that we need in order to succeed as a big distributed team. Early on, the answers for engineering culture are pretty simple. You know, we had this quirky little values document and markdown file with like 10 values. You know, these are things we believe in. I don't think we use that document as much anymore. It was sort of a response to an engineer asking, hey, these guys posted some values, they look great, we should have some too. I was like, all right, you know, let's write something we believe in. And we did that, you know, and it's been spread in our engineering culture since. I don't think we use this document as much as we did, because now it's part of actually how people think in the different locations. And it just transfers, you know, by osmosis and how we behave and how we do things. So I think early on, maybe this was a good stage for the ground, but now it's more about it's how we are. And when new people get in, they just adapt to your culture and take part in it. Then, you know, we had scale our databases and bunch of different data centers, and now we had all these repositories and many apps running all over the world, and all sort of different kind of silos of products that collaborated somehow. And what do we need to do to make this work, right? So we said, here's a big application, and let's split it up. Let's take some things out of it and pass it around to the different offices and give them ownership. I think it's super important to give people a good vision, say, hey, this is your vision, here's where we're at now, but this is the vision. Now you take it and run with it. This is what we believe in, and now you take it and you figure out what is this, and what is for me, and what is for you, and you build it, you know. And we've had tremendous success with that, because in between these different services, we agreed on some APIs, you know, we have our public APIs and these things, and but you can actually give something tangible to another part of the organization, and it becomes much less complicated to collaborate. The first one, of course, is the self-service help center, which is in Denmark. And we give them that. All right, if you need a user, this is what you do. If you want to submit a ticket, this is what you do. But now, create this product on your own. I'm sure some of you recognize what's going on here, and also known as Conway's Law, which says that organizations will eventually end up looking like the structure of the software you're building, the product you're building. You know, it just says that we can't really communicate differently as humans than the technological parts of the system can. So it's quite a mouthful, but you know, that's sort of it. We build out our offices in an optimistic fashion, which is Denmark because we knew people there, open in Melbourne because we knew a great guy there, you know. And that's sort of how we've grown. And then later we just figured out, okay, we've got to do engineering this way as well. So it's not easy though. We learned some lessons, like when you have a remote team, try and hire two of a kind. A single ops guy, a single QA guy gets lonely and it's not cool. Same with product managers and all that. But we learned a lot doing things this way and setting application up. And we're far from done yet. You know, we've been doing this for many years and we're not even there yet. So, can we really make this work? The sort of knee-jerk reaction is to make this stuff work is a lot of process. I don't like that. I think process is sometimes just a result of us not thinking things through and then just accept the lowest common denominator. We need some, but we need to try and keep it down. I think the most important thing we can do to make stuff like this work is to spend time unblocking each other. One way to do that is like, all right, autonomous teams, as we mentioned, you know, give them a mission, don't get in the way, share a vision, you know, guide, but get out of the way. No one should be putting foot down on other people, because more or less, we're all the same kind of people, you know. Why can't you figure that out? Why can't you? So give people some autonomy to explore what the right solution looks like instead of trying to tell them that stuff. We spend a fair amount of time traveling, especially when we have projects that bridge 2 offices or more. We like to invite new engineers to San Francisco for a couple of weeks to get a feel of the culture there and meet the other people there. This year, we're going to be more people outside San Francisco than in San Francisco, but it's still where headquarters is. Having this 50-50 thing is going to teach us a lot about what does it mean to be remote, because all of a sudden we all are. And so we need to travel and see each other and talk about, you know, what works, what doesn't. The pains that I have in Denmark are not the same as the pains in Melbourne or Dublin. So how do we figure these things out? Well, better communication. And then the APIs, I just want to get back to that, because we use, for that or worse, you know, a public REST API for internal communication as well. So dogfooding is a big part of it. We've got to do that and give things to ourselves, to our customers that we can use ourselves as well. I think this is a practical underpinning of distributed engineering. Our mobile apps, our help center, lots of other apps use the REST APIs, and you develop independently of that. Our agent app is an Ember app, but mostly also just uses the public API. So that was a way to spin up how we build product, you know. Good APIs, document them well, have hard standards that you just don't want to budge on, unless they suck. But have hard standards, you know, say this is what an API looks like. There's something to set for good tools. You know, one way to unlock other people is to write tools and automation in the right places. This is a screenshot of Samsung, our deployment tool, which was a product of two different departments in engineering that just could not agree on how to do deployment, San Francisco and Denmark. You know, just two different ways, and we can't agree. Right? All right, we send one from each team to Australia, and you can work with the guy down there, and you build this tool, and we'll all use it. And that's how it went. You know? And so cherish the tools you build. Samsung is open source. Also to keep ourselves accountable, so we don't just start sneaking stuff in that doesn't really work. So. All right, present day, this is the last bit, finish stretch. So we're like 250 people in product development today. That includes ops, QA, sustaining engineering, product management, everything. As I said, 2,500 hosts in production, 4 data centers, lots of repositories, lots of services. But these services are kind of each are very unique in some way. They're deployed in different ways. They have different characteristics, use different application service, whatnot. So some of the stuff we try to address today is like, all right, Docker seems like a good idea for many reasons. There are some cultural reasons. It will help us do some stuff. It will put more responsibility on engineers to upgrade Ruby versions, and you can do that in isolation within a container, for example. And then it just makes sense as a deployment vehicle. You know, you package. Here's my thing, it's never going to change, there you go. We're exploring the DCOS, things like Mesosphere and Kubernetes these days, microservices. I remember like EJBs, SOA, Corba. I'm worried, you know, but I think we have to be worried, but I think that's also, if we stay worried, maybe we have a chance of succeeding. I think it's awesome, but there's something to be said about granularity of services, that's really hard to get right. But you know, we have to go that way because otherwise we can't split up all the work we're doing and also to our many teams. It's going to require a lot of us. Scalable storage systems, obviously MySQL, keeping on sharding that manually, not going to fly. Work on getting that in place. And then you know, a good old port pub architecture that's like 5 years old. Maybe there are better things today. We're investigating at Cassandra and have Cassandra run an entire region and fully replicate it. So maybe we should start doing something else with regional services. Maybe we should get into AWS. We just have high throughput requirements, and yeah, I'll comment on that later. I don't know how many of you follow our engineering blog, but we just open sourced Maxwell, which is a MySQL bitlock to Kafka processor. So everything that gets committed to MySQL, deletes, upserts, insert updates, deletes, alter statements get replayed onto Kafka, which means you can subscribe to any freaking change in the database and do something. So it's becoming the backbone for a new generation of tools for us, which I'm super excited about. And I hate the term big data, but I think when technology like this appears, we have a chance to truly change some of the things that we're struggling with today. For the future, you know, we've come from such a tiny VM to today. And what's next is hard to imagine, right? And we just know that we can't sit still and we have to reinvent ourselves a lot. We have to adopt new technology at a suitable rate. We can't compromise our operational stability. We have to work towards more resiliency, better infrastructure. And we have to not ignore AWS, for example, right? When new companies come in today, you know, they just take AWS, they slap some services on top of it, and then they just wield that as a big gun and point it at you. It's a terrible competitive situation to be in. You know, someone has to build everything themselves, right? So we will actually move more and more stuff into AWS. If not the application service, then backend infrastructure processing, where you don't have the request response latency you need to worry about. AWS, our first pricing investigation with AWS, you know, some people say it's prohibitively expensive, so I just want to address that. I came back and said, yeah, it's going to be four times as expensive to get the same hardware on AWS as running your own. All right, then we kept pushing a little on, and then, all right, if you do 3 years, reserve instances, and get enterprise discounts, it's actually only like 20-25% more expensive, which is an entirely different game, right? It's really within reach to do something sensible with that. Cloud Bigtable, Google Bigtable, I don't know how many do Bigtable, BigQuery, super impressive technology. So we've been in business for 8 years now. We have some impressively large customers. They send us an impressive amount of data, and despite that, on disk, we're like 20 terabytes. That's not a whole lot, right? That could easily fit in Bigtable, and we do some powerful stuff on that. So let's try to replay all that by Kafka to Bigtable. Let's find out what these new technologies can do for us. So we've got to keep our eyes open on all these modern tools that have come out in the cloud, and some of them are really price efficient as well. Last comment here from me. So this here is the guy here. He's this kind of loose cannon. His name is Hasso Plattner. He's one of the co-founders of SAP. And this is him talking about how HANA S4, the new in-memory database, is just fucking awesome. And how if it doesn't work, the bet they're doing now, which is to re-implement SAP on top of this, then they're dead, flat out dead. I don't know that a co-founder should ever say something like that, especially not when HANA S4 in-memory database, it's gonna be available for all of us in AWS a year or two from now, perhaps, you know. So let's sort of remember these kinds of things, that technology will always be like a game changer. It will always change under our feet, and we can't be stuck in it, and we can't bet too much in it because it's gonna be replaceable tomorrow. And I think that the future looks much more like the offerings from Google and AWS than anything that some of the incumbents could build themselves. All right, that was all for me. Any questions? We use test unit.
I was actually wondering if you guys have ever considered moving from Rails due to, you know, scalability problems or whatnot.
Yeah. So our journey has been more about, so what's the animal that's most likely to kill me next? Let me kill that first. And Rails never really made it out there. I will say I would love to see what we could do to speed up our APIs. And I think a lot of the slowness we see there, our average response time is 150 to 250 milliseconds, depending on when we last invested in the performance. And I do think lots of the slowness we see there is for just, it's just garbage we're lugging along for many years of putting stuff in lib or putting in a new middleware, you know. So I'd love to see how that Rails performance really be if we can cut something crop away. But we need faster APIs, you know. We need much faster APIs. For microservices, we need like 1-2 millisecond response times, not 20 milliseconds. So we found that we can actually write in Sinatra like 3, 4, 5 milliseconds response time for internal APIs. But if your consumer plan is written in Ruby, then there's like it takes 20 milliseconds to get the request, get it over the wire, deserialize it, and start accessing it. So we just have all these things to think about. And then it becomes interesting to look at like Scala or JVM-based technologies for infrastructure. We have some Go in there as well. We have lots of Scala coming out these days. So instead of killing off Ruby, we're probably going to build something else that's better, and then transparently start proxying to that. I was just asking Andrew about Elixir today.
I didn't put him up.
I think it looks super sexy, right? And I think if you start something today, why not? Why not bet on it? We have 8 different server side languages going around now. Maybe it's time to sort of let's do something people know how to operate for now. I think earning is a different kind of animal. I'm very excited to see where that goes, and I definitely want to spend time with it. But we're not there to make a decision around that quite yet.
Yes.
Yeah, you know, I think that's a good point. So we chose Rails because made web development so much more easy. We also have nothing to risk at all, right? We have nothing. So today, betting a company on Rails today, you know, 60,000 customers, billions of requests a month, you know, I don't know. But if our startup from scratch today, yeah, it makes sense to have this resilient distributed model of Erlang. That makes a lot of sense, right? And now we find like a web programming language that makes sense for it as well. You know, you don't no longer need to be like this arcane wizard to make it work. And so it makes a lot of sense. I think Charles Nutter has been chatting about JRuby for a long time. You know, I draw the project and the thoughts, but it's just not as fast as people like it to be. It's just not. We use it in some locations for better threading, but I'm not sure that we really need the memory savings.
Right.
One place where it shines is the access to native Java libraries. So we do a lot of email parsing. And then it's taking a little too long to parse an email. We use the Tima library, the old MailGen before it's got a new parser and written in Regal, and it's just still too slow. And then we tried it in JRuby, and we wrapped the old James project, or Java XML, I think it's called now, and it was just 50 times faster. Because this is like, it's just written in a different way, it's a different technology, and it has like 10 years of experience by very dedicated people, you know. So I think that's a good way to get access to some legacy implementations, you know, even if it's hard. Yeah.
And I'm trying to get a lot of your issues, like you could have a relational database, you have your blobs in there, your JSON objects,
yeah.
And you have transactions around those.
Yeah, I think Postgres looks super interesting. This is sort of a little out of my for sure knowledge zone, but I saw this discussion yesterday with people looking for like, so who really does Postgres at real scale, and what are the differences to MySQL? It's not until recently that Postgres got a decent replication story, for example.
Yeah.
You know? I think the native binary JSON support and all these things, Linux capabilities, is pretty amazing. I would choose over Mongo any day. We have some Mongo in there as well. And I'll probably start a new company on it as well, but I don't know at our scale if you know,
yeah.
This or that. It's more important that things are stable and we know the pitfalls.
Yeah, we
kind of do because that's how our database operate. You know, I think we have like 70 clusters and lots of logical databases, and giving them a uniform way to operate those is very valuable to us.
Yeah.
All the devs, of course, want their own schema, and then you think about IP allocation again. Maybe you need to chart, maybe you don't. Maybe it's okay for the voice team or the help center team to just have, all right, own and run your database infrastructure. Maybe that's fine. It crashes, what are you going to do? We can't deny the expertise right in the house. These are super hard trade-offs. So we are introducing Cassandra to the mix and React Enterprise to the mix, saying if your problem looks like it's sort of time series problem or Kubernetes problem, please use these scalable systems instead of MySQL. Because there we can more easily give you your own domain and you can do whatever you want, and we are less likely to run into scalability issues. It's a very hard discussion because I really want to do the right thing for what feels right for development, but I think more importantly, the original story, we gotta be honest on that and say it's a big shift. We're like a top 40 website in the world. You know.
So any other questions?
Yep.
Why did you choose to open the offices in Dublin, Melbourne, and Singapore? Why?
So in Dublin, there's a great history of good IT work. And that was sort of a natural place to put in Europe. We needed a data center in Europe at that time as well, and Dublin is a great place for that as well. So that made a lot of sense for us. Singapore was an acquisition, so we bought a product there, a chat product. Melbourne was this guy, Michael Hansen, he was technically the first employee. He was a friend of ours, and he was stuck in Hong Kong and couldn't work because his wife was working there, and visas made it complicated for him to work. so he was interested in working for free. We were So he joined us, you know, he's a Vista guy, and he later joined us in San Francisco as well. Spent a couple years there, and then he's like, all right, I want to go back to Melbourne where he used to live. So we trust Michael Love and made him GM of the APAC operation back then. So it was also optimistic, you know. So we needed to do something for our agent's application. The agent application is where you solve tickets, basically, which is the productivity tool. What happened was Alexander visited a big customer of ours, Groupon, in Chicago. Then he walked into this room, and he was like, whoa, there are 300 agents sitting there reloading the page every freaking time, waiting to know. All right, we're going to do something else. So we started out building a tight little application backbone. We had looked at Sprout Core, as it was called back then as well. Core one, and we didn't like it. You know, it's too much Objective C UI programming, like, you know. And Sparkle 2 looked promising, but it wasn't really there yet. You know, they had just announced Yehuda and Car and those guys until the whatever they had something before that, I don't remember. Anyway, we started doing things in Backbone, and soon we found ourselves re-implementing the same things that were available in these bigger UI focused frameworks, like the threads. So we decided to go that route and ended up on a very early version of Ember. And I think it gave us the right abstraction in terms of how we want to spend our work. But man, the upgrades have been painful. We spent so much time on making the page load relatively fast. And we were just early movers. And there was no Angular, no React, no nothing back then. I'll take it, yeah.
Mine was like 59
Yeah, I heard there was something about the 1-1-2-1 or 1-2-1-2.
Two.
None of us knew how to build a product development company. None of us, right? And I was, I guess I was too eager to take on all the work myself. we didn't know what it meant to get a Series A or a Series B, but basically means you have to hire some people into the organization, right? And it's incredibly hard to find the right kind of people, people who can really take responsibility. Sometimes you just have to hand it off. So I think I'm many years wiser now, and I'll probably work harder on explicitly getting myself out of the trenches than being stuck in there too long. All of a sudden you're the guy who knows everything, and if you don't work yourself out of that situation, it's going to be some long nights sometimes.
Are there any things you would or wouldn't advise from Series A and Series B?
You have to find a VC that you can work with, someone you trust, it has to be good. And there's some people there who don't really care about you. It's a partnership and it has to work both sides. We dodged a bullet early on. Michael describes this in his book, you know, where this guy was trying to push us into a deal and he was trying to make us feel bad about how we're approaching things, and we were desperate, you know. But we just didn't like him, so we ended up saying no. Because eventually he wanted to put pressure on us so he could get a bigger piece of the cake. Now, you shouldn't mind giving away ownership when you have a startup, you know, that's just how it is. But it has to be for the right reasons. So it has to be people you think you can work with and that can help you. And it shouldn't be further up. Engineering or technically?
I mean, just in terms of people.
So, I love engineering, and I love sitting next to someone personally. I really enjoy the people I've worked with. I think we have so many tremendously great people, And I know you can easily make work with remote teams, remote people, and all that stuff. But honestly, I really like the social aspect of it. I like cursing at the machines while someone else is laughing at me. You know, that's just a personal preference. I think you can make both work. But I can't be alone. At least I know Mick, who's worked with us since the early days. He can't be very alone. He just doesn't work for us.
What if you just require lonely people that are not here?
More power to you. It's great. I won't take it away from you. No, it's whatever works. I think.
I want to touch on this. You use APIs all across your organization to split things up. Do you have a lot of trouble trying to agree a standard? Like, if some person using the API wants like a richer object than another, for example, or all these other API decisions, do you have to be really strict in your standards? Or how the hell do you?
So we have this blessing that we made a really really shitty V1 API. Like the Rails format for XML.json, yeah, to XML.json, everything out there, you know, secrets, whatnot, everything, you know, and had to sort of whitelist, blacklist. I don't know if you guys worked with the serializers in Rails 2.3, terrible, right? But we learned so much from that time, and we learned the importance of having a consistent API, and we learned how you don't include unbounded collections. So like, you know, if you have a post and many comments, you just can't include that in the same API response, because eventually you need to paginate them. That looks terrible. And so you just learn all these little things. And we had 5 years of hard lessons and combined them into a new API and made some decisions. And people have stuck with that.
And is that something publicly in terms of the standards?
Yeah. Our REST API is public.
It's basically that.
Yeah. And it embodies our standards. I know Jason and guys out now, that looks good as well. There's some things they're doing that I think won't work in practice, but I think they'll get to that. But it's great to have that as I think they'll start there today. And pretty much arrive at some of the same things that we've experienced, right?
Right.
Cool.
Alright.
Sure. Thanks everyone. Feel free to find me and ask about databases and stuff. Not that shit.